Now, our next speaker is going to talk a little bit about their experiences in New South Wales, Dominic Herzog. Dominic is a senior project officer for the Office of Environment and Heritage, New South Wales Department of Premier and Cabinet. Dominic joined the EUA team at the New South Wales Office of Environment and Heritage in May 2011. Her role is to work with local councils in New South Wales and consult with industry stakeholders to facilitate the delivery of the EUA program. In a previous role with OEH, she worked with the Neighbours Delivery Team as a team leader. Dominic spent most of her career in the private sector, developing and managing programs and strategies in the areas of occupational health and safety, environmental management and sustainability for large multinationals in the water and wastewater and telecommunications industry. Her first career was in town planning in France, working on developments, master plans and urban renewal projects. Interesting. All right, if you can please welcome Dominic to the lectern.
Thank you. So, good morning. I will try and not to duplicate Scott's presentation. So he went through the EUA mechanism, and basically our model is quite similar in many ways. I will focus the presentation on the main differences of the legislation in New South Wales. I will also give you an update on how we are delivering this model, and also what we are at in terms of projects and pipeline and key lessons. So the main difference, if you remember Scott's schematic with the tripartite agreement that we probably stole in our own communication material, you have in the middle the Sustainable Melbourne Fund. We don't have the equivalent in New South Wales. In New South Wales, the program is delivered directly by local councils. Their role is not to strike the deal. Their role is not to check compliance. They are really a conduit for repayment. So they are a party to the EUA. So there are three parties to the EUA, the local council, the finance provider, and the building owner, obviously. The local council are not a party to the loan. They are not liable for the performance of the work or to check how the funds are used. They are a conduit, and it's not a very nice term, but that's that's a good one. That's their role is to transfer payment to lenders. They transfer only payments that they receive, obviously. And in the process, they recover their cost through administrative fees. And their role is also to enforce and to use their enforcement powers in case of default by the building owners. It's a voluntary scheme, so councils can opt and offer EUAs, or they can decide to not offer EUAs. Once they have opted and passed the resolution that they are going to offer EUAs in their local area, then they are able to opt in or out or decide not to sign a particular EUA for particular reason. And another major difference with the Melbourne scheme, obviously, as Scott mentioned, is that our legislation is statewide. So any council in New South Wales that has set up their processes to be able to levy the environmental upgrade charge is able to join the scheme. And it's really their decision. The role of local councils as well is to promote EUAs with their local stakeholders. The reason why councils are interested in the scheme, Scott mentioned it, but Matt Fisher from Parramatta Council will probably be able to expand on that, are varied. And that was a good surprise when we started deploying the scheme in New South Wales, is that it's not just that they want to retrofit buildings, etc. They want to improve their community, city centers. They want to be able to offer an additional service to these communities and businesses they are dealing with on a regular basis. the role of OEH. So OEH stands for the Office of Environment and Heritage. So that's the state government. Our role has been to pass the legislation, obviously, and I'll give you some timelines later on in relation to when that happened. Our role has been to consult with the industry, and we keep doing that. We are still fine-tuning the legislation and the program. Our role is to advise on the policy intention of the template agreement, being that standard contract that is being signed by the three parties. So we are still providing some advice as the template is being tested by the councils in New South Wales that are offering EUAs on a pilot basis. We also provide support to pilot councils. We are providing seed funding to seven councils over 3 years, 1.7 million in funding. And this seed funding is assisting local councils to establish their processes. Obviously, they need to be able to levy that charge, to transfer that charge and keep proper records. We also support local councils by facilitating the sharing of knowledge and the transfer of information. They work very well together. That's one of the most pleasant part of my job, is working with local councils. They are always happy to share and their processes, their procedures, and what they've learned. The role of OEH also is to engage with stakeholders, but more not at a local level, obviously, more at a peak body level, and promote the program. And we've been doing that for a long time, even so I must acknowledge that I wish we could do a bit more in that space. What we have to remind us of very often in our dealings with the stakeholders is that we are not a party to the agreement. At the end of the day, an EUA is a commercial agreement between three parties. We are not part of that agreement. And at the end of the day, we don't have a compliance role as state government. We don't have to check, we don't have a role in checking eligibility of works, eligibility of buildings, eligibility of councils. We are not a part, it's a commercial agreement. So in New South, and that's a fundamental difference. Eligible buildings in New South Wales are all commercial buildings, and we have a very wide view and understanding of a commercial building. So offices, industrial, shopping centers, aged care, healthcare, educational facilities, motel, hotel, backpackers accommodation even. And because of the type of councils that are engaged in that program, we've seen a lot of interest in applying EUAs to industrial buildings that are usually at the outskirts of metropolitan area, in aged care as well. That made me realize how many aged care facilities are in that suburban areas, and shopping centers. So and the pipeline and the inquiries have shown that there is interest in all these type of buildings. Another difference in the New South Wales scheme is that the legislation allows EUAs to be entered for strata buildings, residential and non-residential strata building. However, at that stage, because it's a bit more complicated to implement EUAs for a strata building, we have not released the template. So in effect, even so, the legislation allows for EUAs to be entered for strata building. It's not possible at the moment. Eligible works, I think the range of works eligible for an EUA is very broad. We are open to the idea of a wide range of works being financed for NUAs, as long as they've got an environmental benefit at the end. And again, it's part of the agreement between the parties. The building owner and the finance providers have to make some representation in the template agreement, and basically it's all around using this finance to for this outcome. So we are not as OEH and state government in checking whether works financed through anyway are comply with the legislation. Another big, big difference in New South Wales is that for a landlord to enter into an EUA, they don't need to obtain their consent from their tenants. So they can decide to enter an EUA. All they have to do is make sure that they let their tenants know if they intend to seek contributions from their tenants. They have to make sure that there is some transparency in the calculations and that they provide annual reports to their tenants. So basically, under a net lease arrangement, no consent is required from the tenants. There is no requirement to change the lease. However, there are some tenants' protections measures in the legislation that are very important to remember and to comply with, obviously. The contribution that the landlord asks from their tenants cannot exceed the savings that the tenants are going to make from the retrofit activity. So if the following the upgrade, the tenants see some savings on their utility bills, then that equivalent proportion can be sought by the landlord as a contribution in a way. So tenants should not be worse off as a result of an EUA. And obviously, landlords need to make sure that they communicate early with their tenants, that they keep communicating with them. And it's another lesson that we've learned from going through that exercise in the last 18 months or so in New South Wales, is that initially, we were expecting a lot of backlash from tenants, and that has not been the case. Tenants, and I will let my colleagues from the EUA team in New South Wales talk more about, you know, how an EUA can be driven by tenants, and I think it's a real, very interesting prospect and a real one. I've put here something about an EUA being entered on the gross lease arrangement and tenants contributing to that. It's not specifically mentioned in the legislation. I don't think that was designed for that purpose. However, that works, as the first EUA in New South Wales will demonstrate. We are also packaging EUAs with other offers. We've got in our office what we call the Energy Saver Program that provides technical support to businesses for energy efficiency, and we are teaming up with them so that they can provide advice to businesses. That's something else we've learned. This mid-tier property sector usually doesn't have the resources and understanding to be able to manage an energy audit, for example. So by teaming up with these guys, they offer that advice, put the business case together, and they can also sell EUAs, and we've started seeing the benefits of that. And it's something also that councils are very grateful about. They don't have the resources to be able to advise businesses on where to start with your project, so they refer these projects and these inquiries to our guys. So status in New South Wales, we passed the legislation in February. The first template was released in October 2011, which means from that date, council could opt in and offer EUAs. We've got four councils offering EUAs at the moment. The last one, Lake Macquarie, passed the resolution on Monday night. We signed the first EUA in New South Wales on Tuesday. Yeah. We've got three other councils planning and working on establishing EUAs. Newcastle and Penrith are expected to offer that in March, and Wollongong in June next year. Key lessons so far. So mid-tier sector, I think we realize we knew very little about it, unless Melbourne and South Australia, because our role in New South Wales is different. We have not done much market research. This has been done by councils at the moment. They are interested in retrofitting. They are unsure about finance options. That's what we've heard. Another big lesson is that it takes time. So we passed the legislation in February, and for some reason, everyone expecting everyone to start and sign EUAs. That doesn't happen like that. It takes time, and we had to manage expectation. However, we've got a good pipeline. I would not be surprised if in the next 6 months we add 4 or 5 EUA signed for a variety of projects, a variety of setup in relation of tenant contribution, gross lease, net lease, and things like that, and a variety of buildings as well. So I think it's very promising. And finally, what we are doing at the moment, so as I said, we are fine-tuning the commercial template agreement. We are going through ongoing consultation. We are going through the pilot phase as well. So we will learn and probably review the template, hopefully not the legislation, but who knows. We want to bring more councils on board. We receive very regularly queries from building owners or service providers. They have a project ready to go. It's in a council area that is not offering EUA, so we will need to do something about that. And also, obviously, we need to tackle the strata template. It's a work in progress, but we hopefully next year we'll be able to do that. That's it.